Good evening once again from the MCG. We're in just a...
Great play by Peter Dacos. His kick to half forward. Starcevic. Oh!
The fear of actually losing against Collingwood and having to front people the following Sunday or Monday and have to cop all the slack over getting beaten and, it was more a fear than anything at all. But...
Barwick in the pocket. Can he keep it in play? He'll have to fend it back.
You're taught as a professional footballer to hate the opposition, that doesn't matter who it is, because you've got to have that fierce desire to beat your opponent and the club you're playing every time you go out there. But with Carlton, it's something special, and I'm sure the feeling for them is the same against us.
They live to play us, and there's no doubt that there's something special when we have to play Collingwood, and we try and find that bit extra.
Torpedo
here, he does, and thumps it,
look at that, it's
home. See, every time they met, it was vital. We were either knocking at the door of the finals, or they were knocking at the door of the finals. There was never a situation where one was at the top of the ladder and the other was at the bottom.
When the ball is bounced at the MCG tonight, it will begin the 204th meeting of footy's greatest rivals, Collingwood and Carlton. One of the game's great traditions enters its second century.
You can get some idea of how far back that tradition goes when you consider that it was almost 40 years before Farlap won the Melbourne Cup, more than two decades before the start of the First World War, that Collingwood and Carlton had that epic first encounter here at Victoria Park on the 7th of May 1892. And on that day, 16,000 people saw the Blues win by 8 points.
In years to come, the battles continued to rage between the Magpies and the Blues. And according to one of Collingwood's oldest living players, Bruce Andrew, it was around the time of the Magpies' four successive flags that the intense rivalry was born.
It possibly started during that 1930 era, because there were a couple of incidents that took place out on the field at that time that... were carried on year after year.
Even when you first come and join the club, you hear so much about the Collingwood-Carlton clashes that it's just sort of born and bred in you to it's going to be fireworks when you play Carlton.
I had many clashes with him, especially with John Nicholls. I took him on one day and I ran into him. I thought he was running into a brick wall, so I never took him on again. He was tough.
They've always been good games, no matter where Carlton and Collingwood are on the ladder. They've been, as I said, torrid affairs, and they've been great combats between the two clubs, great rivalry.
Most of the past champions dismiss the notion that the rivalry stems from Collingwood being the working man's suburb, while Carlton's image, especially in recent years, has been that of affluence. But whatever the cause, emotions run high. Magpies legend Bob Rose has more reason than most to feel passionate about beating Carlton. He was the coach who felt the full force of the Carlton comeback in the 1970 Grand Final.
We still should have won the game, and that's the real disappointing part of 1970. We were clearly, I think, during the year, the best side, but it's the Grand Final that counts, and so I still owe Carlton one.
And if that was one of Carlton's great moments, so too was the 79 Grand Final, which will be remembered forever by Wayne Harms.
That's rolling towards the boundary line, and Harms almost makes ground. He taps it back to Sheldon, and it's a goal!
Now, you've got to tell me, was it in or out, Harmsy?
I believe Banksy said in the paper yesterday that it was 8 rows back, but the proper story, I believe, is that it was in the Jollymite rail station. Depends if you're barrack for Collingwood or Carlton.
For the Magpies especially, tonight's game holds great significance in this, their centenary year.
The reason why the Magpies are celebrating their centenary this year can be traced back to the cellar here at the Grace Darling Hotel in Collingwood. After all, it was here that Australia's most famous football club was born. It all came about after a bitter split in the Britannia Football Club in 1892. And so it was here that the Magpies came into existence, and this secluded little spot became their first ever committee room.
100 years on, the club they formed has become known in many parts of the world. It's a club so steeped in tradition that it's the subject of a special exhibition at the Gallery of Sport. Love them or loathe them, nobody could deny that the Magpies are unique. They've been that way for 100 years now, and they probably will for 100 more.
It's just in your blood all the time, and I think the fanaticism of the supporters really tops it right off.
I've met such wonderful mates and friends, and the Old Players Association or Past Players Association is such an outstanding success. You're with friends all the time, and I love that.
You know, the old theme song, they stick so tight to the old black and white, write their names up in letters of gold. That's very true, and it has been and it will always be.
It's no wonder these two...
..of the match, on the bench, the reserves bench. What happened from then, Ted?
Oh, well, I was fortunate enough, of course, to get a run, and the game turned dramatically, and, of course, there were four goals to me and a victory for Carlton.
You kicked three in the third quarter and one in the last.
Yes.
Tell me, do you still keep up with the game now? And looking at this magnificent ground tonight, it must tug at the heart.
Yes, I was really looking forward to coming this evening, and it is this stadium that does make it such a special occasion, and I think it's a great compliment to Melbourne that the new stadium is such a magnificent contribution to the city.
..is what legends are made of. What memories their matches stir, and what champions, the marks...
Oh, Jesaulenko, you beauty! Up towards the half-forward line, Carter.
The goals, the arguments still rage. Was this ball out or not? The Blues won by 5 points.
Oh, what a goal!
The famous clashes, both fair...
He is out cold!
..and not so fair.
David Reece. Oh, he's top one!
It's been going on for years. Harry Collier and his brother Leta both played in six premierships. Harry won the Brownlow Medal in 1930, the year Collingwood completed a never-repeated four flags in a row.
I've seen plenty of rough games against Carlton. Now, they had a fellow named Chitty playing with them. Straight away, you give him the back and the flip. Give him two elbows in the old belly and he'll go quiet. Now, that was Chitty. He was a bad boy, but a good boy. Unfortunately, he's not about these days to defend himself. So I can say this about old Bob Chitty.
Even last year's game was like this. Let the spark ignite.
It's very nasty here.
Well, it should be something.
BG, Melbourne Cricket Ground, the home of Australian football. With the great Southern Stand, it can put claim to being one of the world's top sporting arenas. And I know what it's like to have 100,000 plus fans screaming as you go for the ball, because I was there for three grand finals. Who could forget 1970, when Carlton came back from the dead at half-time to belt Collingwood again? And it's been going on for a long time, because Carlton and Collingwood have been at each other's throats for 100 years. It was at Victoria Park, Collingwood, on May 7, 1892, that the black and white legend was born. Those two colours sum up how Collingwood sees the world and vice versa. Love 'em or hate 'em, the Maggies have produced many great footballers, but none better than the man you're about to meet.
Of course, you realise, Harry, this is the first time in my 43 years of living that I've been allowed into this holy room.
Well, you could have come in, Rex. You've dodged it.
Harry Collier, Brownlow medalist as the best and fairest player in 1930, captain of Collingwood from 1935 to 39, and with brother Albert, better known as Leta, played in the side which won four successive premierships, a feat unlikely to be equaled.
When you played against the Carlton Football Club, were there any fireworks?
One day I was playing up there, you know, it'd be in the 30s, I heard that grandstand, and Rex... You've played up there, haven't you? In front of that one-eyed grandstand, worse than Collingwood. I heard this roar go up, and I look around, and there's me brother Leet laying back in the ground. And what do you think's happened to him?
He fainted.
He fainted, but someone hooked him. I really forget that fellow's name now. He was supposed to be a fair player, but I won't mention his name because I forget.
But they have long memories, that Collingwood mob, especially where Carlton is concerned. Just ask Collingwood president Allan McAlister.
I'll never forget the 1970 grand final when we were 7 goals up at half time, and 7 goals in those days was a very big amount, and we should have won that. And as you know, they won by 10 points with a fellow called Hopkins that came on the ground at half time and kicked 4, which was a big amount to kick in those days. And the anguish and the heartfelt sorrow of that and the unforgivingness of it will never go away. We'll never, ever forget that, and we'll never stop trying to get equal for it.
They've gone to the world at half time, but they kicked 7 goals in 10.5 minutes in the third quarter, and Carlton have won the grand final of 1970 here.
The man who pulled the rabbit out of the hat for Carlton that time was super coach Ronald Dale Barassi.
You've done that before, Barass.
A few times, Rexy. What's doing?
Well, of course, we've got a big game of football on tonight. Carlton and Collingwood, and I hope you're not going to be late for our big broadcast there, but a lot of people, particularly your fans, Ron, think that you made your name on the football field. I've got a little birdie, excuse the pun, tell me you made your name running over magpies in your car as a kid up around Castlemaine.
Well, it was a bit later than that, Rex, but it's true. I have to admit to this, and it's not a very nice thing to, in my more mature stages of life, to admit to that, but yes, when you think of magpies and you're a football fan, you either love them or you hate them. And in my case, it had to be hate because my father played against them, I played against them. But they say there's only one thing better than beating Collingwood by 10 goals, and that's beating them by 1 point.
Jones behind Thompson, up over the top.
Champion Blues ruckman Peter Percy Jones remembers hatred of Collingwood being drummed into all Carlton rookies.
I arrived here from Hobart in 1966, and Barassi, as soon as I hopped off the aeroplane, he just started hammering us and me about the Woods, how we had to beat them, how he hated them so much.
And tonight's game will be no exception. Collingwood coach Leigh Matthews is a bit of a cuckoo in the magpie nest as a former Hawthorn champion. But in 1990, he gave the club its first premiership in 32 years.
I think it's just a fantastic event that a game is being built up with such a big crowd, pre-match entertainment, sort of like a finals game in May.
But perhaps the final word should belong to Ron Barassi.
Now, Ron, this match has been billed as the match of the century. Do you have a message for the Collingwood people?
Yes, Collingwood fans, read my lips.
More after the break.